Cane River Baptist Church and all of you who are joining us across the internet this morning. I want to welcome you into the house of God on the Lord's Day. As you gather your families around the living room and you get your copy of the Word of God, please turn there in your Bible to 1 Samuel chapter 17. And while you're turning there, let me just say I want to thank you, church, for your encouraging words and just how encouraging you have been to your pastor during this time. It's not easy for us preachers to come in and to preach to an empty auditorium. It's not easy to walk in and to see the church doors close and it be so cold. It's not easy. It's heartbreaking, honestly. But I do know that God is still on the throne and He will open this thing back up and hopefully very soon, very shortly. But I want to thank you. You'll never know what it means for all of you who are putting those thumbs up and the hearts on Facebook. You're sharing the messages and the gospel's been going out. For those who have been texting and calling and saying, "Preacher, we just want you to know that we're praying for you, that we love you, we appreciate you." And I just want to take time just to thank the Lord myself for all that He's doing. I never dreamed, and I knew He was going to do some good things. I knew that God was going to show up and show out, but I didn't know just how He was going to do it. But He's done it in mighty working fashion. We are reaching people all across the United States and even in the world, and people are texting me and calling me and encouraging me over this matter. And for all of you who have been sharing these messages, you know who you are. And I'm oftentimes reluctant to mention names because if you leave one out, you know, people get their feelings hurt and they tend to, but forgive me if I do, but we're reaching some of my family that are down on the coast in North Carolina, Nancy and Conley Bourne, and I appreciate you guys and your encouragement. My Aunt Jackie, who lives in Raleigh, and Carrie, Fawn and Rocky, who comes and visits us often when they can when they're in town. My good friends down in Florida, Brother Tommy and his sons Matthew, Caden, his mother Carol, and Brother Bill, we appreciate you. My good friend in Indiana, Brother Denny Neff, and his good family, and one of our own, Brother Brian and Caitlin Brewer, as they live a world away in paradise in Hawaii. We appreciate you, Brother Brian, and you bravely serving our country and our nation. We appreciate that and all the support that they've been given during this time. And so with that said, be turning in your Bible, if you're already there, in 1 Samuel chapter 17. It is, church, it's just amazing to see how God has been allowing preachers to just step out of their comfort zone and to be able to deliver the gospel message. And what a joy that is. I thank God for every preacher who has been delivering the word during this time in unique ways. I thank the Lord for you. Now, we are going to look in the Bible today and we're going to take a journey back in time to a time in Israel's history where they faced the Philistines on the fields of battle. And the Bible tells us that the battle has dragged on and for 40 days now. And the Bible also tells us that Goliath has blasphemed God. He has paced back and forth on the battlefield as he's calling out a challenger, someone to meet him in single combat, somebody that would come out and be brave enough to determine who was going to win the war and who was going to win the battle. And no doubt as the Israelites, they saw that hulking figure, that giant of a man blaspheming God and challenging them. And no doubt that the soldiers looked maybe one to another and they said, "I don't know about you, but I'm not going nowhere near that big rascal." It would take a team of men to take that man down, much less one of us, so I'm not going out. And see, in Greek culture, when they fought battles, and they would fight for several days, and if there wasn't a clear winner, and there wasn't a clear side that was just victorious, what they would do is they would send out representatives from each side of the battle, and they were their champions. They were the mighty men of valor. They were the ones that were the strongest and bravest fighters in the army. We're thinking men like Hector and Achilles. And they would send them out, and they would spar off in combat, and whoever was left standing, that is who they determined was going to win that battle. It saved a lot of bloodshed. It saved a lot of time in those days, and that was their culture. And to them, that was who they deemed that the gods, that those fake gods, the many gods in which they served, and who they smiled upon and they would shine down upon and who was to win. But you see, the Israelite army, the people of God, they didn't understand this. This concept to them was foreign. You see, they didn't worship many gods, at least they shouldn't have. And at times they did stray from God, but they had one God, and that was God Jehovah. And if they were going to send out a representative, there wasn't anybody that day that was volunteering. If they were going to send out a representative, it would have been the most logical choice would have been their king. For the Bible tells us that Saul was head and shoulders taller than any man in all of Israel. The problem was their king was not volunteering either. Nobody wanted to go out there and face that giant of a man who stood near 10 foot tall. And that is when the Bible tells us that a volunteer emerges from the most unlikely of places. Out on a shepherd field, there was a shepherd boy who comes down to the battlefield and he overhears the talk of that giant. He sees his nation, he sees those his brothers and those soldiers there that day, and they're not making a move. They're quaking in their sandals and he doesn't understand. He was discouraged that day. And David utters those famous words, "Is there not a cause?" And if you got your Bible there on your lap, look down in verse 32 of 1 Samuel 17. And the Bible says, "And David said to Saul, let no man's heart fail because of him. Thy servant will go and fight with this Philistine. And Saul said to David, thou art not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for thou art but a youth, and he a man of war from his youth." He's saying, now listen here, son, I appreciate your grittiness. I appreciate your courage and your fire and your passion. But son, you are out of your league. You are in waters that are over your head. There's no way in this world that if you go out there that it's going to be anything but certain death for you. I appreciate what you're saying, but run along now. And David says to him, he says, now listen here. He said, "And David said unto Saul, thy servant kept his father's sheep, and there came a lion and a bear and took a lamb out of the flock. And I went out after him and smote him and delivered it out of his mouth. And when he arose against me, I caught him by his beard and smote him and slew him. And the servant slew both the lion and the bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine shall be one of them." And seeing he hath defied the armies of the living God, David said moreover, "The Lord hath delivered me out of the paw of the lion and out of the paw of the bear, and he will deliver me out of the hand of this Philistine." And Saul said unto David, "Go, and the Lord be with thee." When Saul was saying, David, here was a man who was raised from his youth. They said, now you're a youth, but you're a shepherd boy. And here's a youth that he has known nothing but battle, nothing but war, nothing but fighting and killing and dying. Ever since he was your age and even younger, you don't stand a chance. And here David is. He said, hey, listen, he is no different than that bear. He's no different than that lion. And God will deliver me from that uncircumcised Philistine. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, God, as we bow before you here today, Lord, I pray that your holy presence would invade every living room, would invade every home, and strengthen every child of God. Lord, we pray and ask today, Lord, that in times in our lives when things just don't seem to fit, when things just do not seem to make sense, God, I pray that you would help us to trust in you like that little shepherd boy. I pray, God, that we would put all of our eggs in one basket and in no other God but you. I pray, Lord, that you would just help every one of us to grow in faith during this time. Lord, I'm so thankful that your words went out and it's rung out through the land. God, that you took root in the home in America once again. And when we meet back again, I pray, God, that revival would storm through this world and through our counties and countries and cities. In Jesus' darling name, we ask and pray all these things, Lord. Amen and amen. Now, in life, we are going to encounter times when things just do not make sense. You say, preacher, boy, if that ain't a truth, I don't know what is. In life, we are going to encounter times when things just don't seem to fit. And the other day, little Callan, he was looking at me, and he wanted me to play dress-up and with his superhero costumes that he has. You see, we have all these little superheroes, and Callan can put on the helmets and the mask, and he's got the capes and all that fun stuff and the things that they wear for their fist. And, well, Callan wanted me to dress up with him, and so he brought me a couple of things, and I began to put them on. There's the problem. I was too big for them. They just didn't seem to fit. And you can imagine how hilarious your pastor looked with a Batman mask on and some of this other stuff on my face, and I got my big old fat cheeks pouring out the side of it. And little Callan, and he's dying to laughing. And I'm telling you now, there was, needless to say, there was nothing heroic about that sight. Me being poured into those little bitty capes and hats and things. And I wasn't going to save the world from anything, maybe save a box of donuts. But Callan, he's cracking up and he's rolling. And he looks up at me and he says, "Silly daddy, that just no too fit for you." And I said, "Do what?" And he said, "Daddy," he said, "you're so silly." He said, "That no too fit for you." And you see, Callan, he's three, and he doesn't know how to say things at times, and he's cute when he comes out with stuff like that. But when he said that, that was Callan's way of telling me, "Daddy, you're too big for that. It just doesn't fit you." And that's just the way it is in life sometimes. Life seems sometimes that things just do not fit. Things just don't seem to work out. Things don't make sense. That's just part of life. And even though little Callan here, when I had those things on, in his little eyes, as ridiculous as I looked. And honey, I did. I looked aside. Let's just put it that way. To Callan, he thinks his daddy can do anything. And while you guys would have looked at me and like they've got the camera out and posted my picture all over and plastered it all over Facebook, and I'd have never lived it down, to my son, when he looks at me and I had that on, he thinks his daddy can do anything. Now, we know that during this pandemic, when all the projects and everybody is burning Lowe's up and burning the Home Depot up, my wife looks at me and she says, "I saw so-and-so, Todd, we're looking at you, and who can do all these things and doing all this stuff, and I want you to go out." And, well, nothing like that's got done around the house because I can't do much. I said, "Well, when it's safe for somebody to come in, that we'll have them do it. We'll just pay to have them done." So you understand that your pastor is a limited being. I have boundaries that I can't go past. I'm a limited creature, but I know one who is not limited. I know one who has no boundaries. He can do anything he sets his mind to. He can speak the word, and honey, it is done. I serve a God, and you serve a God who can do all things, and he can take a weak, frail, fragile creature just like you and I, in all of our disease and sickness and all the things that we find ourselves in, our inabilities, and God can do mighty things. Aren't you glad for that? He can take a nothing. He can take a nobody and make a somebody out of them. God does this with people to accomplish his will and his purpose for our lives. Now, I believe as I preach upon that thought here for a while, no too fit for you. Thank you, Callan. Thank you, honey. As I preach on that thought, when sometimes in life, things just don't seem to fit. But there is something that'll fit everybody, every child of God, that is. And that is the armor of the Lord. It's the armor of God. It's something that he wants us to place on us so we can avoid the wiles of the devil, temptation in this world, when the flesh rises up and the devil attacks you. We need to wear and adorn the armor of Almighty God. First of all, I believe God would have us to see God's armor fits when no one else's will. Now notice this. When I was looking at myself in the mirror, And I got a glimpse of myself with a head a mile too big and too long for that little mask that I was wearing. The thought ran through my mind how David must have felt when he began to put on Saul's armor. Now imagine, Saul has went and got his royal armor, and the king's armor, and he's going to place it on that young boy, that young lad. You got to realize here that Saul is head and shoulders taller and bigger than all of the men in Israel. Imagine how it must have looked on that little boy. If he would have took any soldier in his ranks and his legions and brought them in to where he was at and placed his armor on them, it would have draped off of them. I'm not real sure what he was thinking, but this is what he did. So he equipped David with his tunic and his armor. He places his royal helmet on his head. He gives him his sword in his hand, and David walks around before him and he tries to maneuver. He tries to see if he can wear it. The problem is, and we all know this, David's too small and the armor's too big. You see, Saul, he's a 52 long. David is a 36 regular. It'll hit you in a minute. David is a 36 regular and Saul is a 52 long. It's just not going to fit. Saul was a warrior king and David was a shepherd boy. Saul was a grown man and yet David was a teenage boy. That which would help Saul in battle would have hindered David. Saul's tunic did not fit. His helmet was too big. His sword was too heavy, and David could not fight in it. He couldn't walk in it, much less fight in it. And upon all of that, if that wasn't enough, David hadn't proven it. What do you mean, preacher? Well, he had never picked up a sword probably in his life. He had never worn armor in his life, and so here he is. Now look down in your Bible with me here for just a moment, verses 38 and 39. And the Bible says, and Saul armed David with his armor. And he put a helmet of brass upon his head, and also he armed him with a coat of mail. And David girded his sword upon his armor, and he essayed to go, for he had not proved it. And David said unto Saul, I cannot go with these, for I have not proved them. And David put them off him. Now it appeared when David went into battle, when he walked down there toward the Philistine army and that giant, it appeared as though David went into battle with nothing but lip service from the king. When the king said, go and the Lord be with you. He said, if you're telling me that God's telling you to go and it's the will of God for you, I'm not going to stop you. So if you want to go, be it for me to let to come in between you and the Lord here. You head down that way, but God be with you, because, honey, you're going to need him. You're going to need the Lord. You're going to need a miracle. And my dear friend, that's exactly what David had. The Lord was with him, and he was going to receive a miracle. And I love this. The Bible says that David went into battle with what he knew. And some of you guys, try not to get too excited now. David went into battle, it'll hit you in a minute, with what he knew. And aren't you glad today that you and I can go into battle with what we know? We know that God is for us, then who can be against us? We know that God works all things to our good for his glory. We know that God has never lost a battle. He knows nothing of defeat. And honey, he's not going to start with you today. And he's not going to start with somebody else tomorrow. We know some things about God today. And David went into battle knowing that God was with him, a very present help in a time of trouble. God knew that David knew that God had delivered him before from the paw of the bear and the paw of the lion. And he knew and believed that God would deliver him again. And my friend, you're going to notice something in life. Life's greatest battles are not physical battles. I realize that our bodies, they are weak at times and frail, and you don't really understand how fragile we are until you get something like arthritis, a disease comes upon your body, and you have cancer, or you get sick with a bug of some kind, or you fall and get hurt or have an accident. then you realize just how fragile these bodies are. But the greatest battles in life are not physical. They are spiritual. And the Apostle Paul says here, we're to put on the full armor of God. In Ephesians chapter 6, he says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Not your might, not mom and daddy's might, not the preacher's might, not the church's might, but he said, in the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. And for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. He said, wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God. That doesn't mean just a piece here and there. He says, wear the whole thing, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Now this includes truth, peace, prayer, and faith. It includes all of those things. But here's the problem. The problem is, like David here, we sometimes, oftentimes try wearing somebody else's armor. Come on now. Somebody say amen. So oftentimes we try wielding somebody else's weapon. What do you mean by that, preacher? Somebody else's gift. Somebody else's God-given talent. Something that God gave somebody else to use is not exactly maybe what God is wanting you to use. He equipped you maybe with something else. But this is what I want you to see here today. Notice this. Watch this. Do not miss it. There is only one of you in this world. I don't care if you're a twin or if there's somebody that resembles you or you act like somebody. Listen, there's only one you in this world, and that's it. When God made you, He broke the mold, and you don't have to try to be somebody else. Whoa, now, here's the problem, especially in churches. We see people and they're trying to be somebody else. Now, I'm not telling you that you can't have a hero in the faith. You ought to. But you ought not put them above God, and you ought not put them on a pedestal. All right? Now that we've got that established, now that we've got that settled, you can look up to people. You can have those heroes in the faith. I have mine. And boy, I tell you what, I love them, and I love them dearly. And I look up to them, and I aspire to be like them. But we need to realize that you're never going to be able to pray like somebody else. You may never be able to sing like somebody else or worship like somebody else. And come on now, this is where it's going to get real for a minute. Some of you preachers that might be watching, you ain't going to be able to preach like nobody else either. I see this happening all the time where preachers, they'll get, they look up to a certain preacher who has a real the touch of God on his life, and they go here and preach a revival, and next thing you know, they change their whole style and their whole way of preaching, and they're trying to preach just like that other guy, instead of preaching the way God told them to preach. I know that when I actually was called to preach, my daddy looked at me and he gave me some real good advice. He said, son, don't you try to be somebody else. Don't you try to mimic some other preacher. He said, you be who God called you to be. You be you, and you let that be the end of it. Amen? But listen, we don't have to worry about being somebody else, because God made you the way He made you, and He's going to use you and the way He made you, because He made you with a purpose and with intent in mind. But sometimes we envy and we covet other people's talents, other people's gifts, or their weapon, and we covet that, or we envy that, and we try to aspire to have those things. But the thing is that that might not be what God has for you in your life. There's not always going to be, and everybody can't be Billy Graham. That's just the way it is, as much as we like to be. But you know, it's often bothered me, even before I got saved, I could see this. I mean, a blind man could see this. It doesn't take a person with glasses on their head to be able to see it, or with a magnifying glass, but you see this happening in churches. One person gets to singing, and God opens up the windows of heaven, and heaven comes down. And boy, everybody else is like, man, boy, I wish I could sing like that. Oh, I want God to move on me like that. Next thing you know, they're trying to sing in a way that they've never sung before, and it's a total train wreck. You see, one preacher gets up and preaches, like I said, he preaches a revival, and every other preacher in the county is trying to be just like him, and it ain't going to work. God made you for the congregation that He has planted you in. And so you got to preach the way God made you. You see, one church, and this is probably where it really gets real, is where one church has revival and one church has a great moving. And I mean, God just really has His hand on that one church. And everybody else, they've never had, every other church doesn't have an original thought in their mind, and they try to mimic and copy everything they do, and they want to be a carbon copy of that one big church, that one church that's just out doing it all. But listen, friend, that might not be God's will for your church. That's just the way it is. God does not move and work in cookie cutter fashion. We'll get in that in just a second. Now, don't misunderstand me. God will always, as long as you're following Him, as long as you are not sinning and out living in open sin or in private sin, God will honor His word, and He'll use you, and He'll use your church. But here's the problem. Sometimes people get the wrong idea. They think, well, we don't have church unless brother so-and-so runs the aisle. We didn't have church unless sister so-and-so threw her hands up and had a big shout and spell. Well, we didn't have church unless somebody walked the back of the pews and swung from the chandelier. We didn't have church unless the choir sung the duration of the service and the preacher didn't get to preach and the altars filled up and all that. Now, I love those services. I really do. And that they're amazing when God is in it. Notice that. When God's in it. I've seen people come in. I saw a fella come in a church house one day. He walked in the back of the door of the church and was shouting like a Comanche Indian, and he didn't have a clue, not a clue, what was going on in the church when he came in. And guess what? God wasn't in it. Sometimes God just wants you to be able just to sit down, just shut our mouths, be quiet, be still, and listen to what the man of God has to say. There may be somebody there in the pew that needs to hear the message, and somebody needs to get right with God and needs to hear the word of God. It's okay, churches across America. And I've heard people, for you not to have a shouting service every service. You know, I've heard people, and they come up to you at dinner, and they say, boy, we had a good service, boy. We've just been seeing God move in the church, boy. The preacher ain't preached in 3 months. And you're thinking, well, give it about 3 more months and you're going to see a world of hurt, because it's through the Word of God that we need preached. It's the Word of God that's going to keep us on the straight and narrow. It's the Word of God that's going to get people saved. And God sometimes will take a back seat to all the worship and all the praise and all the singing just so a sinner can hear the Word of God. We need preaching of the Word of God in pulpits across America today. Boy, when God does come down and He does show out, boy, it's good in those times, but that's not always the case. Some of the sweetest services that I've ever been in my life, I didn't hear not one shout, not one amen, but you look out and you see hands going up, you see tears rolling down faces, and you do see people come to the altar and get their heart right with God. Sometimes we need to be still and know that He is God. But you see, I want you to be encouraged today that God does not use cookie cutter molded Christians. God does not use cookie cutter molded churches. When God makes you, there is only one CRBC. There is only one Cane River Baptist Church. There is only one Pastor Matt Mills. And while there is another guy down the road that has my name in Spruce Pine, that's okay. There's only one of me. And I know some of y'all are sitting at home saying, praise the Lord, we couldn't take more than one of you. But you know what? I want you to know that there is only one of you as well. So don't worry about being somebody else. Now I'm going to tell you why that should excite you this morning. It's because you are God's masterpiece. You say the Bible says that we are God's masterpiece? You better believe it. In Ephesians chapter 2 verse 10, the Bible says, for we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Now, Notice this. Had David went into battle wearing Saul's armor, had he went in with his weapons, David would have surely lost. Goliath would have stomped a mud hole in him and walked it dry. He would have slapped him like you take a fly swatter and swatted a fly. It wouldn't have been much of a battle. He would have surely died that day on the battlefield. And likewise, don't you dare try to be somebody that you're not. Don't you dare try to be somebody that you're not, wearing somebody else's armor, trying to wield a weapon that you were not made to wield, that God did not give you the talent or the ability to wield. Whatever you have in your hand, like we'll find out here in just a moment, David went into battle with what God gave him in his hand. And God brought the victory. God brought the giant down. Not David, but God delivered the victory. And he'll do it in your life too. I want you to know that God knew what David needed to succeed. And God knows what you need to succeed for him as well. Now I want you to look here. Watch this. Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 10 did not say that we were God's appliances. Say, preacher, what do you mean by appliances? Well, I mean by appliances, the things you would buy at Home Depot and Lowe's and Best Buy. Appliances. When they make an appliance, they, what they do is they make it in mass production. They're cookie cutter molds. And they stand them out there on the shelves and they're exactly alike. I want you to notice that when God made you, God never made an appliance. God does not mass produce things like that. When he made you, you were a masterpiece. When God made you, he took the Father's hands, the hands of the carpenter, and as he took those tools and he whittled away at your life and he formed and made you in your mother's womb with every carving tool, with every stroke of his hand, there's a groove that's not there in somebody else. There's a vein in the wood there that's not in somebody else. There's a brush stroke that's just a little bit different. As he moves and he molds his hands upon the pot, that pot and that vessel, it may look a lot alike. It may resemble something else, but the master's hands and the potter's hands, when they're upon that vessel, there'll be a thumbprint, a handprint. It'll be just a little bit different. There's a signature there in the master's hands. You are his masterpiece, and there is nobody in this world quite like you. And nobody can do the job that you can do except you, because God made you to do it. God called you to do it. And it's up to you whether or not you're going to do it. Amen. Oh, yes. God's plan for shaping you will not look like his plan for anybody else. You see, God's armor fits when no one else's will. Secondly, God's armor fits those who trust it to fit. For those it fits. For those who trust it to fit. Now, when I was a lot younger, when I was a little boy, my mama used to buy my clothes. And some of you little ones sitting around the house, you know what I'm talking about when I say this. Mama doesn't always get it. Now, honey, she may know your size. She may know your favorite color. But she doesn't always know what's cool. She doesn't always know what's in. She doesn't always know what's not. And I remember one day, I said, I knew Mama. She bought my clothes, and I just cringed. And I went to school one day. It was like, I think, sixth grade, getting ready to go into seventh, eighth, ninth. You know, you'd be around those upperclassmen. It's in that area where you're not really a kid, but you're not a man yet either. And you're in that in-between zone. And I remember Mama got me a T-shirt, and there was a picture of a miniature schnauzer on the front of it. And it said, happiness is a miniature schnauzer. I'll tell you what wasn't happiness was when I got to school with that shirt on and all the boys picked on me. And I'm telling you what, I could have burnt that shirt by the time I got home. But I'll tell you this much here today, that God knows exactly what you need to wear. He knows exactly what to equip you with. He's not like Mama. He knows. And he will not make a mistake. And we see David here in the scriptures without any armor of his own, and he's going to do a task that no man in his right mind would have done without armor and a sword and a shield. That's like getting in a car with Jessica. and not putting your seatbelt on. If you get in a car with Jessica and you don't wear your seatbelt, you're either a couple of fries short of a Happy Meal, you're not cooking and working on all cylinders, or you got a death wish. Drive with her sometime. You'll find out. You'll know exactly what I'm talking about. But here David goes. Look down in verse 40. The Bible says, "And he took his staff in his hand and chose him 5 smooth river stones out of the brook and put them in the shepherd's bag which he had, even in a scrip, and his sling was in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistine. And the Philistine came on and drew near unto David, and the man that bare the shield went before him." Now, we do not know what the conversation was between the soldiers that day. But I imagine, I'm going to hypothesize here for a minute. I'm just going to kind of assume what their conversation might have been like as David, he goes in the battle as he's walking down. Maybe one of the soldiers looks over to another one and says, "I want you to look at that crazy teenage boy. He doesn't have a helmet." And the other one says, as he's going down in there, "I want you to look at David, the son of Jesse. He's going into battle and he doesn't even have a shield. Not only does he not have anything to protect himself with, he doesn't even have a sword. All this kid is carrying is a bag of rocks, and he's going to try to bring this giant down with a sack of rocks. He's going to go out there and he's going to throw stones at this mighty man of war." You got to understand here, those Israelites, those soldiers, they had everything that David needed. They had the armor. They had the experience. They were battle-hardened. They had been fighting. They had the helmet, the shield, the sword. They had it all, but they didn't have the courage, and they didn't have God on their side on that day. They didn't have faith. But out there walking onto the battlefield was that little shepherd boy, and not one of those men tried to stop him. All the things that David would have needed, they had, but what David had was so much more. One of the most extraordinary things about this story is that the king and the people, the soldiers there that day, did not try to stop David. But they allowed him to go fight a fight that he could not win. They sent him to his certain death. And I couldn't imagine for one second sending our young people to go fight a giant. Now I know our young people are amazing. They're extremely talented, and they are destined for greatness, and they can do a lot of good things, but I would not, and no doubt this church wouldn't let them go out and fight a battle like that against a giant. You know, I was thinking, Miss Lisa told me a story about Andy when I believe he was about 10 years old, and she said he got gone, he got missing, she couldn't find him. And she found him in the garage in there with the car, and he, that youngin, at 10 year old, he had found his daddy's jack. He had jacked the car up, got the tools out, that little drill, and he had plugged everything up, and he had took the tires off the car and rotated the tire. And Lisa said, "I about killed him." She said, "I thought I was going to kill him." I said, "Now wait a minute here, Brother Gary, Miss Lisa, that's one of those moments in life, that's a proud mom and daddy moment. You can't get angry at a 10-year-old boy who rotated the tires on your car. I'm 39, and if you said, Pastor Matt, I'll give you $1 million in cash money today to go out there right now and rotate the tires, we'll even get everything and set it up, and we'll even talk you through it, I don't think I could do it." But you see here, I can't imagine in my mind, though, somebody sending out little Andy to fight a giant. A man that's almost 10 feet tall. A man who has known nothing but war. And a teenage boy at that age going out there to fight it. To fight a giant. The Philistine champion. The greatest warrior that they had to fight a fight he could not win. When all the armies of Israel was not willing, there was a little shepherd boy that was willing to go. You see, God sent David. You say, why, preacher? Because God needed somebody who trusted him. God needed somebody who believed in him. God needed somebody who was already walking with him. God needed somebody who was willing to step up and step out by faith. God needed somebody that knew that he wasn't going to win the battle in themselves, in their own might, but they knew and they
They realized that it was going to be God that was going to deliver. Just as David knew that, friend, he had been delivered from the paw of the bear, the paw of the lion. And now, David, he knew he was going to deliver him from that old Philistine giant. Oh, yes. When no one else was willing to go, God sent a shepherd boy. God called one who was. It just so happened to be a teenager. You see, God, he equips those he calls. God, he equipped and he qualified those he called. He strengthens those he calls and he uses those he calls. We see here that God's armor, it fits when no one else is willing. It fits those who trust that it will. And thirdly and lastly, God's armor fits those who are willing to wear it. Did you hear me, church? It fits those who are willing to wear it. And you know, this has always bothered me in church. After I got saved, it especially bothered me. How people can claim to be saved, and yet their lives just don't back it up. And their spiritual fruit tree is naked and bare. And there's no excitement, there's no enthusiasm, there's no desire. No, not in their heart. There's no passion. They say that they're for the cause, but they're just not necessarily supporting it. But they're for it. They're saved and they're going to heaven. I wouldn't be so sure. But here is grown men not willing to fight a battle, but yet a little boy is going to fight a man's battle. A little boy is going to do a job that should have been done by man. And he's taking a rock to a sword fight, and he doesn't even have a chance. You know what I've got to thinking about this? And do you know that some of the greatest revivals in America were started by the young people? Just about all of them. Do your homework. Research it. Look it up. I promise you that almost every revival that was big that started, it started with the young people. You say, why? Well, sometimes, sadly, the older generation, you see, they've been saved for a while and they get complacent. They do. They no longer have that first love. And they're no longer as excited. They're saved now, they're saved, but they're not as excited as they used to be. And they just let one day bleed into another. And they're no longer as excited about what God brought them from and where they could have been. And they just let Calvary kind of, because we've heard Calvary and Jesus so much that you've heard it, it's almost just like you don't understand it. You don't grasp what happened. And sometimes it takes a young person, a young boy, a young girl to get saved and to get on fire for God and to realize what God saved them from and where they were going without God and to let that fire burn bright. And when they get around the older generation, guess what happens? A revival begins to start and they breathe a new life in them and they say, yeah, they go back to a time in their life where God, he saved their soul. He called them out of the world in a pits of sin where God used them in a mighty way and the Lord brought them out of that wicked lifestyle. Sometimes it takes the young person, and here the Bible tells us that a younger generation has stepped up in David, and he has been sent by his father Jesse to go check on his brothers down in the battle. And when David gets down there, he hears something and he sees something that will change his life and the life of Israel and the course of their history forever. As David hears that giant blaspheming God, yet he looks and he's looking around like it's nobody going to do something. It's nobody going to say anything. It's nobody going to run out there and smack that giant right in the mouth for blaspheming our God. No, David looked around and he said, is there not a cause? Is there not a cause here today that we can stand up for God? That's what we need, like those little children sing. Stand up! Stand up! For Jesus, that's what we need to do today. We need people to be sitting on the premises and to start standing on the promises. Amen. That's what we need today. I ask you today, is there not a cause for good, holy living? Is there not a cause to live holy, righteous, sanctified, set apart from this wicked world and its system? Is there not a cause to let your light shine for this whole world to see, to glorify your Father in heaven? Is there not a cause, my friend, for us to do our part, to roll up our sleeves, to bow our neck, and to say that we're going to go out and get on the firing line for Jesus Christ? I ask you today, is there not a cause worth fighting for?
before we lose every freedom. This world and this government, they'd like to take our Christian freedoms away from us. And they're trying, and they're doing a good job. They've already taken God out of the school, out of the courtroom. They're already doing these things, and they'd love to see the church doors shut too. Don't you think that they would? But I believe that one of the most frustrating things about a Christian is when other Christians get on fire for God, and you got some others, they just don't seem to get it. And they don't see the seriousness of the situation. They don't see the importance of their job that they've been given to do. And they'd just rather go home and sit on the couch and watch TV and watch movies and things like that, and they go to the ball games, and they just forget about God, and God's just tacked on to the end of their life. They don't get the sacrifice that Jesus made at Calvary. Therefore, they're cold, they're indifferent, they're just whatever about God. And it's demoralizing to be on fire for God, and nobody else want to be on fire. But just like this virus, if we could just get on fire to the point that we would say, Lord, when we burn bright for you, that everybody that we come in contact, Lord, like a contagion, Lord, everybody that we see, Lord, that we just pass that spirit and a light of fire in them. You see, we don't know the conversation here today. I want you to know this. We don't know the conversation that went on between those soldiers. We hypothesized, we assumed, we gave a good educated guess. But what we know what the conversation was between David and Goliath. Look here, some of our young people would say, David was talking some smack. Let's see here. In verse 42, the Bible says, and when the Philistine looked about and saw David, he disdained him, for he was but a youth and ruddy and of a fair countenance. He had rosy cheeks. The Philistine said unto David, am I a dog that thou comest to me with a staves? And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. And the Philistine said to David, come to me, and I will give thy flesh unto the fowls of the air and to the beasts of the field. Notice what David said. If that giant would have said that to most anybody else, probably those cowards back behind there and the lions and the soldiers there, they'd probably tuck tail and ran. But David said, and then, the Bible says, then said David to the Philistine, thou comest to me with sword and with a spear and with a shield, but I come to thee in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom thou hast defied. And this day will the Lord deliver thee into mine hand, and I will smite thee and take thine head from thee. Now notice here, here's a boy who has come to battle with a sack of rocks, and a bag of rocks, he has not even have a sharp object in his pocket, and he's saying, I'm going to take your head clean off your shoulders. It's like my daddy said one time, he said, you got to be careful. He said, he gave me some good advice. He said, don't ever mess with a man that doesn't have a neck. What do you mean, preacher? Well, if a fella, if you say something to him and he can't turn his head and look at you, and he has to do this number and rotate his whole body, you best leave him alone. And here, I believe that old big meat-headed giant, he had a big old thick neck. And David said, I'm going to take your head off your shoulders. And he said, I'll give the carcass of the host of the Philistines this day unto the fowls of the air and unto the wild beasts of the earth, that all of the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. And all this assembly shall know that the Lord saveth not with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands. You see, here God is. He's using the most unlikely, the most least likely of all the people to deliver and to accomplish his purpose and his will. You see, God, he does this. How encouraging this ought to be to us today, that God used a stuttering, stammering tongue in Moses to deliver his people from 400 years of Egyptian bondage. That he would use a little boy's little leftover lunch to feed 5,000. That he would use Rahab the harlot to hide the Israelite spies, and who would later go on to be in the bloodline of Jesus Christ. He used Abraham when he was old, Jonah when he was out of the will of God and running from the will of God. He used Matthew, who was nothing but an old wicked tax collector, and ain't nobody like tax collectors. And God used Saul when he was persecuting Christians, and Gideon when he was scared of his own shadow. And now we see God using a child, using little David to bring down a giant. What are you saying, preacher? I'm telling you here today that God's armor fits those who are willing to wear it. Let's recap the victory, shall we? No great length here. No reason to go into great detail. It's simply like this. The sling get hurled. He loosed the stone. The Holy Spirit guided it. We heard a thud. Impact was made. The giant dropped like a tree. Have you ever seen somebody get hit in the jaw or maybe in the chin or the temple? And they're out on their feet for a couple of seconds and they literally fall over like a tree. I believe that's what happened that day. As the armies of the Philistines flee into the hills, and those cowards that were afraid to go out in the battle before, they begin to chase on after him. As David stands upon the giant with his head in his hands, and he severed the head of the giant. We must realize today that God can do all things. He can. Even when things are no too fit for you, like little Callan says, even when things don't seem to fit, when things don't make sense, when things are too big and are out of control, He will use us in our weakest moments with our inabilities and our inadequacies to do great things in our lives for Him, for His honor and His glory. Listen to me. Can you imagine here? God, and I just thank God, there I was that day looking in the mirror, and a little three-year-old boy looks up at his daddy and he says, "Silly daddy, that no too fit for you." God look over the balconies of heaven and say, "Honey, there's your message for Sunday morning." When life no too fit for you, when things just don't seem to fit, when things don't seem to make sense, God, just trust Him. Wear His armor. It'll fit you. Let us pray. Lord God, thank You, Lord, for this day. Thank You, Lord, for all Your blessings. And I pray, Lord, that every heart was ministered unto today. I pray, Lord, if there's just one that's lost and can't say that they know Jesus Christ as Savior, Lord, that today would be the day. I pray, Lord, that all of us would put on the armor of God, the full armor of God. Lord, that we would wear it and trust You, believe in You, Lord, that we may be able to, when the devil attacks and the flesh rises up in us and temptation is presented, Lord, that we can flee it. Lord, that we can live for You in the way that You call us to be. Lord, help us to realize that You made us to do a job that only we can do. That there is only one of us, Lord, that we are Your masterpieces. God, we'll thank You and we'll praise You. In Jesus' name, we ask and pray all these things. Amen and amen. Church, I miss you. I love you. Please stay safe until we meet again. Good day. God bless you.